try this yourself. It's extremely dangerous.
We'll be talking about the surgical anatomy of the vitreous. Just an overview of what we'll be discussing in the presentation. We'll start with microscopic anatomy of the vitreous, discuss about peripheral retinal degenerations, the vitreous base, talk about PVD, anomalous PVD, the cisternal and bursal anatomy of the vitreous, anatomy of the pars plana, ciliary body, abnormalities of the vitreomacular interface, how the vitreous behaves in various vitreoretinal pathologies, and brush up on hereditary vitreoretinal degenerations. So this is surface anatomy of surgical importance. The spiral of Tillaw, which is a spiral when we join the insertions of the four recti, approximately marks the location of the ora serrata. And vitreous consists of 80% of the eye volume. It consists of mostly type 2 collagen, hyaluronan, and 99% of it is water. There are two parts of the vitreous body, the core vitreous and the cortical vitreous, which can be divided into the anterior hyaloidal membrane and the posterior hyaloidal membrane, which is 100 microns thick above the ILM. This diagram shows the diagram of the vitreous body, and here we have the patellar fossa, which houses the crystalline lens of the eye, and we have the Weigert's ligament behind that, which is a band of firm vitreal attachment just behind the patellar fossa. Then there's a potential space called the space of Berger behind the Weigert's ligament, which continues as the Cloquet's canal in a sinuous manner throughout the central part of the vitreous cavity and ends in an area just above the disc called the area of Martigiani. Also, the direction of the collagen fibrils is of importance. At the vitreous base, we have collagen fibrils which are running radially inside or in an anteroposterior direction from the base. They are parallel, continuous, and do not branch. Whereas in the vitreous cortex, these fibrils become parallel or circumferential to the inner retina. Here they are densely packed, and the central fibrils will undulate and go parallel along with the Cloquet's canal. The ciliary body, the anterior border of the ciliary body is confluent with the iris root, whereas posteriorly it is confluent with the ora serrata. The width of the ciliary body is wider temporally as compared to its nasal width. And the pars plicata consists of the anterior 2 mm, the rest is the pars plana. The surface landmark is it ranges from 1.5 mm posterior to the limbus to approximately 7.5 mm posterior to the limbus. So that's the range when we look at the surface. Now, why is the pars plana important? It is relatively avascular, so it gives us surgical access to the posterior segment. Again, the pars plana is wider temporally. So when we make sclerotomies, temporal sclerotomies, the pars plana is more forgiving because it gives us more margin of error. The pars plana is also overlapped by the vitreous base more temporally as compared to nasally. The ciliary body, lens, and the retina attain adult size by 7 years of age. So when the eye is growing up, and we are doing surgery in pediatric eyes, so we should know the anatomy of the pars plana vis-a-vis the limbus. So here we can see that this is the scleral spur, which marks the anterior border of the ciliary body. And researchers have assumed a length of 0.35 millimeters from the posterior margin of the surgical limbus. So the ciliary body, including the pars plicata and plana, will go from here up till the ora serrata here. And we should have some margin of error so that we don't go through the retina when we're making sclerotomies. So in one of the studies, they assumed a safe distance of 1 to 1.5 millimeters from the ora serrata to make a safe sclerotomy through the pars plana. So this was the normogram given by Lemley and Han. They assume normal ocular growth and development. So this does not apply to ROPs. And what they said was that in an age group of 1 to 6 months, it is safe to make the sclerotomies at 1.5 millimeters posterior to the limbus. 6 to 12 months, 2 millimeters, 1 to 2 years of age, 2.5 millimeters, 2 to 3 years of age, we can make it at 3 millimeters. And in adults, as usual, 3.5 millimeters in a phakic patient. But we might have certain situations like the anterior is the retina is anteriorly pulled up. We might have trauma. We might have vitreous hemorrhage, or we might have distorted anatomy like anterior segment dysgenesis, PFV. So these are situations in which we might not know where the pars plana is. So the safest way to identify the pars plana intraoperatively is we can do scleral indentation with indirect ophthalmoscopy, localize the area of the ciliary body, and then make the sclerotomy. Another way of doing it is through transillumination. So let's say that we want to plan a sclerotomy at 9 o'clock. So we illuminate the, there's a special transilluminator for this. So we can use transillumination at 3 o'clock. And externally, it will show something like this. So this is the iris, which appears as a dark or a dark zone. Then this is the aura, which is again a dark zone. And between that, we'll get an area of transillumination, which we can safely assume to be the ciliary body. The vitreous base is an area of firm attachment to the retina, and it extends 2 millimeters anterior to the aura into the pars plana and 3 millimeters posterior to it. It has strong adhesions with the basement membrane of the non-pigmented epithelium of the ciliary body and the ILM of the retina. It never liquefies, so intraoperatively we can only trim it or shave it, but not disinsert it. There is an age-dependent posterior migration of the vitreous base, which is important surgically. So it can even reach up to the equator when it migrates posteriorly. This posterior migration is more prominent temporally. The mechanism of this posterior migration is that there is intraretinal synthesis of collagen fibrils. These fibrils penetrate through localized defects in the ILM and intertwine with the collagen fibrils which are already present in the basal gel. So this is a diagram which depicts the posterior migration. This is the ora serrata. And we can see that this migration is irregularly straddling the aura. Somewhere it is more posteriorly migrated, somewhere not. So the clinical importance of this is in the pathogenesis of horseshoe-shaped tears. So when there is evolution of PVD and the PVD reaches up till the posterior vitreous base, the PVD continues to evolve here, whereas this is an area of strong attachment because it's the vitreous base. So this area tears off along with it and causes a horseshoe-shaped tear. Intraoperatively, it is important to identify this posterior extent of the vitreous base because beyond this, we should start shaving the vitreous and not be too aggressive. So why is a horseshoe-shaped tear a horseshoe-shaped? Reason being that PVD always extends from posterior to anterior, so the directional force of vector is always towards the aura. And like we talked about, the posterior migration of the vitreous base. Why is it most commonly located equatorially? Posterior border of vitreous base, we've already talked about that. But why equatorial as well? Because vitreal fibers at the equator have an oblique insertion. So it is more easy to tear something at an acute angle rather than pull it up vertically. And also, as compared to the posterior retina, the peripheral retina keeps on getting thinner. So it is easy to tear something which is thinner. Now, we sometimes encounter anterior hyloidal proliferations. So this is a complication of when we do surgery for vitrectomy for PDR, we can see late rebleeding at about 6 to 8 weeks post-operatively. The cause of this can be anterior hyloidal fibrovascular proliferations, which can either grow from the vitreous base, which acts as a scaffold, or it can even grow from the sclerotomy site, what we commonly refer to as port site proliferations. So this is a photograph which shows this is a sclerotomy site related proliferation. This is the sclerotomy site. This is the anterior hyloid, which might not have been trimmed during the surgery. And these are the prolifs which are growing along the anterior hyloid, which is acting as a scaffold. There is role of UBM in diagnosing this condition. And it is also an indication of free surgery. If we get repleading along with anterior hyloidal fibrovascular proliferations on UBM, we should go inside and trim the prolifs to the extent possible. Now, talking about physiological evolution of PVD, posterior vitreous detachment is defined as the separation between the posterior vitreous cortex and the ILM of the retina. Vitreous liquefaction can start as early as 2 years of age in the precortical vitreous pocket, which is also known as the premacular bursa. We'll be talking about this later. With age, there are more numerous pockets of liquefaction as well as the already existing pockets keep on enlarging. Then there is dissolution of the posterior vitreous cortex and the ILM adhesion at the posterior pole, which we can call vitreoschisis. This allows the liquefied vitreous to enter the retrocortical space, initially via the prepapillary hole and the premacular bursa. Along with rotational or kinetic eye movements, this liquid vitreous dissects a plane so that the PVD enlarges. Since there is volume displacement of the liquefied vitreous from the central vitreous cavity into the retrohyaloid space, this causes collapse or cinerosis of the vitreous body. One of the good things about PVD is that it may protect against PDR because it denies a scaffold for FVPs to grow. The completion of PVD can take 6 months or even longer. So if we have a patient who comes up with acute PVD, we should closely follow up the patient. So maybe call the patient 3 to 4 weeks after, or as and when required, after explaining the signs and symptoms of retinal detachment. And then if everything is fine at 3 to 4 weeks, we can increase the follow-up duration to 2 months, so on and so forth, till the PVD completes. Just something to think about. This is a picture of a vitreous corpus. The ocular cords have been dissected off it, and it has been illuminated with dark field slit microscopy. This is the area of the lens, and this is the area of the macula. This is an 83-year-old lady. It shows multiple pockets of vitreous liquefaction along with formed gel. So when we give intravitreal injections like anti-VEGFs, we do not know what is happening inside the vitreous. We might give off the drug in an area of liquefaction, or we might be giving the drug in an area of formed vitreous. So just something that needs to be thought about is whether this affects the amount of drug delivery to the macula or the pharmacokinetics of the drug. So what is anomalous PVD? Anomalous PVD will occur when vitreous liquefaction exceeds the degree of weakening of the vitreoretinal adherences. So we have areas in which there is firm vitreoretinal adhesions, and they do not want to separate. So that leads to anomalous PVD. Conditions like myopia, diabetes, and inborn errors of metabolism predispose to an anomalous PVD. So the various sequelae of anomalous PVD are, we can have either vitreoschisis, or we can have an IPVD. So this is a full thickness schisis, not a vitreoschisis, and we have an IPVD. So we have either vitreoschisis or we have IPVD. Now this vitreoschisis leads to usually to tangential contraction. If the force is centrifugal, it leads to a macular hole. If it's centripetal, it leads to a macular pucker. And anteroposterior traction from vitreoschisis can also lead to VMT and tractional retinal detachment. An IPVD can have peripheral separation or posterior separation. So it can either lead to VMT TRD, vitreopapillary traction, or if there is peripheral traction, it leads to retinal tears and detachment. So vitreoschisis is splitting up of the posterior vitreous cortex into multiple layers. It mimics true PVD. The remnants of the cortical vitreous are attached to ILM in areas of firm vitreoretinal adhesion. The surgical significance is in identifying a second membrane when we're doing diabetic TRD surgeries. So this is the plane of true cleavage. This is vitreoschisis. This is the plane of true cleavage. So when we dissect this, we'll be able to completely relieve the traction. This is just surgical video which shows the presence of a second membrane. Here the prolifs are being peeled off with the help of an intraocular forceps. Here beneath that you see an area which is shining. So this is the second membrane. So after trimming the prolifs, when we go beneath the second membrane and peel it off, we'll be able to completely relieve the traction. So we can have physiological or pathological areas of strong attachment of the vitreous. The physiological attachments in order of their decreasing strength are the vitreous base. Then comes the optic nerve, the macula. The macula has two concentric circles of firm attachment. One is 1 millimeter in diameter from the foveola. Another one is 4 millimeters away from the foveola. Then we can have paravascular adhesions along the major retinal vessels. Pathologically, chorioretinal scars, enclosed dura bays, meridional folds and complexes, cystic retinal tufts, horizontal tractional tufts, and lattice degeneration have strong attachments. This is an enclosed ora bay, which can mimic a true hole. So we can call it a pseudo hole. How to differentiate this from an actual retinal hole is that the surface will be brownish, and it will have a more granular appearance. And one study found that up to 17% cases have tears posterior to the bay, but then this is just one study. Now, meridional folds are developmental folds of redundant and thickened retina, which occur at the ora. The traction in them is in an anterior-posterior direction, and the edges are undermined. Usually, this occurs in the superonasal quadrant. We call it a meridional complex when a meridional fold gets aligned with an elongated ciliary process, which is seen in this diagram. The ciliary process is getting elongated, and then they're aligned. Meridionals also have slightly increased risk of developing tears at their posterior border. Cystic retinal tufts are nodules of retinal tissue which are surrounded by cystic degeneration. Clinically, they appear discrete, circumscribed, and opaque white lesions. And zonular tractional tufts are thickened zonules, which is displaced posteriorly and attached to the anterior retina. Both of them can lead to increased vitreoretinal traction and may lead to tears, but there is no indication for prophylaxis for them. The most important peripheral retinal degeneration which can lead to retinal tears and detachment is a lattice degeneration. This is a gross pathological photograph of a lattice which has an overlying area of vitreous liquefaction. It has an area between the arrows where the ILM is discontinuous, and it has an area of firm vitreoretinal adhesion at the edges. And we have sclerotic vessels centrally. We can also have adhesions around the vortex ampulla. So the filling and emptying of the vortex ampulla usually occurs when there are rotational eye movements, and this filling and emptying is very rapid. Because of this rapid nature, it can lead to localized vitreoretinal degeneration around the vortex ampulla, along with changes in the vitreous. The vitreous can liquefy, sometimes be adherent around the vortex ampulla. This gives a propensity to develop horseshoe-shaped tears, especially in the STQ vortex vein. Now, coming to the cisternal and bursal anatomy of the vitreous, Jan Wurst dissected the vitreous corpus, dissected out the ocular coats. Then he started injecting colored ink into the liquid vitreous spaces to see the anatomy of the vitreous. And he found that there are various cisterns and bursa, especially the premacular bursa, which are present in the vitreous. So he found that there is a premacular bursa. This is the optic disc, the arcades, this is the macula. So he found that there's an area of excessive early vitreous liquefaction, which he called the premacular bursa. And we have the Cloquet's canal, which contains liquid vitreous only. So he found that in like a hand in glove appearance, these two pockets of vitreous liquefaction fuse anteriorly at a distance from the optic disc, and then it continues along the sinuous course of the Cloquet's canal to the back of the lens. This is well seen even in SGOCT. So we have an area above the disc of the where we have liquid vitreous of the Cloquet's canal, and this is the premacular bursa. This is going and joining here. This area is relatively larger. Or we can even have syndromes like Stickler syndrome, where we have an optically empty vitreous and massive amounts of vitreous liquefaction. So this area is appearing optically empty. They also found out that there are some prevascular thin fissures which radiate upwards from the second or third order vessels. And they're more so in older subjects and myopes. They probably are the premacular cisterns which were observed by Professor Wurst. So this is the classic diagram that Professor Wurst gave. He said that there are three orders of cisterns present in the vitreous. This is the first order, which contains 72 cisterns, and these are the most peripheral, present near the ciliary body. Then we have the second order of cisterns somewhere in the mid-vitreous cavity. These are more posterior and more central as well. So there are 36 cisterns here. And then around the premacular bursa, you have around 12 cisterns. What we can derive clinically from this anatomy is that it might describe the configuration of fibrovascular proliferations in PDR. So fibrovascular proliferations have a lot of scaffolds to grow. We have the hyaloid, which has started separating. We have multiple vitreoschisis planes. We also have the macular bursa. And also, the bleeding into premacular bursa may describe the shape of boat-shaped hemorrhages. Also, they may have a role in pseudophakic CME when we have a complicated cataract surgery or we do a conventional ECC. There are a lot of prostaglandins which are produced in the anterior uvea. These may travel through the cisterns, come into the premacular space, and cause macular edema. Now, this is the International Vitreomacular Traction Society classification of VMT. So we have vitreomacular adhesion, which is basically perifoveal vitreous detachment with persistent vitreofoveolar attachment. VMA is generally asymptomatic and may resolve on its own as well. Then we have VMT when we have distortion of the shape of the macula. The patient usually becomes symptomatic in these conditions. The pathogenesis of non-diabetic and diabetic VMTs is different. Diabetic VMT pathogenesis is more related to inflammation, whereas non-diabetic VMT is what we have been talking about throughout, is more related to the development of anomalous PVD when we have posterior traction and peripheral separation. They have also divided VMA and VMT into broad and focal categories. So focal will be called as an area of adherence which is less than 1500 microns in diameter, whereas broad will be more than that. This is also somewhat like the second membrane that we discussed. If we have a tractional component in the CME, we have an ERM and we have an IPVD with persistent vitreomacular attachment. We can even have the ERM grow into the IPVD as it's acting like a scaffold. So again, we can't go from here and dissect the and relieve the traction. We have to actually go beneath the ERM and peel it off as well. So this entire story starts with vitreous liquefaction. Is there any way we can prevent vitreous liquefaction? Because that means that half of vitreoretinal pathologies will now not be there. So this has been studied in some animal models. What researchers did was they injected some proteoglycan mimics into the vitreous of bovine and porcine, vitreous. And they found that these proteoglycan mimics had the ability to maintain the gel-like structure of the vitreous. But because of the complex nature of the collagen hyaluronan interactions, so we actually have a difficulty in developing an artificial vitreous substitute in the real world. Well, let's talk about vitreous in various pathologies. The pediatric vitreous, the vitreoretinal interface has very strong adhesions. We might not be able to induce a PVD intraoperatively in all of pediatric eyes. And also extra care must be taken when we are dissecting preretinal membranes in this age group. Also, we can have persistent fetal vasculature. So the indication for posterior segment surgery can be either we have a posterior PFV with tractional retinal detachment or vitreous hemorrhage, in which we do a lens-sparing vitrectomy, or we can have combined anterior and posterior VFE in which we need to sacrifice the lens as well. So do a lensectomy along with a vitrectomy. If we are doing a lensectomy along with a vitrectomy, we can either make the sclerotomies at the limbus or go just behind the behind the iris root, then enter into the anterior chamber. Following lensectomy, the central stalk of the PFV has to be cauterized. Since the ciliary body processes are also dragged anteriorly and centrally, so we can get hypotony in such cases. It is important to dissect the ciliary body membranes to the extent possible and try to reattach the ciliary body. But if the retina is totally detached around the vascular stalk with thick vitreoretinal adhesions, surgery may not be advised in some patients, or if we do go in, it may have to be abandoned in some cases. In diabetes, we have precautious liquefaction because of hyperglycemia. Hyperglycemia leads to cross-linking of the collagen fibrils, and this leads to precautious liquefaction. Risk of PDR is less in eyes with PVD, and also we say that the role of PRP in proliferative diabetic retinopathy is to convert ischemic areas into anoxic areas. But another indirect role can be that PRP induces PVD. If we have a complete PVD, PDR is less likely to progress. So this is a diagram which shows the vitreous detachment in PDR. We have a blood-lined IPVD here, subhyaloid hemorrhage here. We have an area of traction in which the fibrovascular proliferations have started growing along the vitreous scaffold. This diagram also explains the nature of boat-shaped hemorrhages or subhyaloid hemorrhages. So because inferiorly the heme trickles down in the subhyaloid space, it can reach only up till the area where the PVD has been induced. So if we see this anteriorly, we'll see boat-shaped hemorrhages. So boat-shaped hemorrhages denote the anterior extent of PVD. And here we have an area of intragel hemorrhage. Mechanism of TRD involves vitreoschisis, which will lead to tangential or circumferential traction, and also because of the anomalous PVD, which gives rise to an anteroposterior component of traction. How's the vitreous and wet AMD? Research studies have shown that eyes with vitreomacular adhesions or VMT show less improvement in BCV after anti-VEGFs for wet AMD. They have hypothesized that VMT can cause low-grade inflammation and can also act as a barrier to effective delivery of anti-VEGFs. So they did a study where they studied the role of ochreplasmin to resolve VMA in exudative AMD, and they found that in eyes where they used ochreplasmin as compared to sham injections, fewer anti-VEGFs were required in the eyes in which the ochreplasmin was used. Now, we've already talked about myopic vitreopathy. PVD can occur at an early age and we can get more vitreous liquefaction. Also, there can be abnormally strong adhesions at the areas of chorioretinal degeneration, myopia, and at the edges of a posterior stephyloma. How does vitreous play a role in the pathogenesis of a giant retinal tear as compared to a normal, as compared to a horseshoe-shaped tear of normal size? So here in GRT, we have an area of massive vitreous liquefaction, and there is traction at the vitreous base, which leads to HST. This is a routine pathogenesis of an HST. So the anterior flap is pulled more anteriorly by the vitreous base. It is kept open. But there is no support of the posterior flap. Usually we will have gel vitreous here, which will give rise to an HST and not let the posterior retina slip. But since this vitreous pocket is liquefied, the vitreous seeps in, there is posterior slippage of the retina and gives rise to a giant retinal tear. In proliferative vitreoretinopathy as well, when we have a total retinal detachment, we might have an area where the vitreous cortex is densely adherent to the surface of the retina. This pulls the retina, forms a narrow funnel, eventually leads to a closed funnel artery where we can have transvitreal sheets of traction. Now, coming to hereditary vitreoretinal degenerations, we have various types of chondrodysplasias associated with vitreoretinal degeneration. The most common chondrodysplasia is Stickler syndrome. There are four types of Stickler syndrome. Type 1 is associated with a membranous vitreous, whereas type 2 is associated with a beaded or a fibrillar vitreous. Type 4 is again associated with a membranous vitreous. Along with that, we have various systemic features in Stickler syndrome, like hearing loss, facial dysmorphism, joint pain, cleft palate. This case report shows a case of Stickler syndrome where we can have multiple radial or perivascular lattices with perivascular sheathing and widespread areas of chorioretinal degeneration. The child also has a cleft palate. Then we can have Marshall syndrome, in which, how do we differentiate this from Stickler syndrome? In Marshall syndrome, we have more pronounced facial dysmorphism but a lower frequency of retinal detachment. And Nies dysplasia has dwarfism. Knobloch syndrome has congenital encephalocele, and Weizenbacher-Zweymuller syndrome does not have vitreoretinal features. Initially, the syndrome used to be called Stickler-Wagner syndrome, but now we have said that Wagner syndrome is a different entity because there are no systemic manifestations in Wagner syndrome. The ocular manifestations of Stickler and Wagner remain the same. In X-linked juvenile retinoschisis, there is fragmentation of the inner layer or the inner leaf. So we can have widespread fragmentation of this layer. This layer can be in shreds, what we call as vitreous veils. Also, when PVD occurs in such eyes, it can induce hemorrhages into the sciatic cavity. The surgical importance here is that the vitreous is densely adherent to this inner layer. So in many cases, to completely relieve traction, we might have to do an inner layer retinal layer retinectomy to ensure that this traction gets completely removed. And also, since retinoschisis, the area of retinoschisis has absolute scotoma, removing this inner layer will not have any effect on the scotoma. So the patient will not feel any deleterious effects of removing the inner layer. Also, removal of the inner layer allows better visualization of the retinal outer retinal breaks, as well as it helps us to achieve a complete oil fill. So the goal of surgery in retinal detachment of X-linked retinoschisis is to achieve chorioretinal adhesions of the outer breaks. After that, it is followed by laser to the outer retinal bricks as well as to the edges of the sciatic cavity. So this is an intraoperative photograph which shows the laser has been done to the outer bricks, and also this is the area of sciasis. There are also some laser marks at the edges of the sciasis cavity. In Goldman-Favre syndrome, we'll have a normal anterior segment, but we'll have features of progressive vitreous liquefaction, chorioretinal atrophy, pigmentary degeneration, retinoschisis. But the patients are usually hyperopes as compared to myopia, which is more common in these hereditary vitreoretinal degenerations. So the common features are that we have an abnormal vitreous with anomalous PVD, high rate of vitreous liquefaction. This can lead to high incidence of retinal detachment because of large tears, which are mostly posterior in location. And we can use IVTA to check for complete PVD induction. And if we cannot relieve the peripheral traction entirely, it is always better to put a belt buckle or combine it with a scleral buckle. So the take-home message from this presentation is, Jerry Sebag has called the vitreous a resplendent enigma. And understanding the role of the vitreous in various vitreoretinal pathologies will help us as vitreoretinal surgeons in tackling these situations better. Thank you. So we can look for the posterior migration of the vitreous base as well, because that is clearly seen as a PVD line. Usually we encounter it intraoperatively, but we can have signs of, we can actually see the incomplete PVD sometimes. We can see vitreous floaters. Or we can have, if it's an anomalous PVD, we can have areas of abnormal traction. So if there's a tear, so that definitely means that there is anomalous PVD. And we can have syndromes where vitreomacular adhesions are there. So we can have VMT and things like that.
Even visoring also does not mean that you have complete PVD. Okay, we still have a few layers can be attached. Mm. Just what it shows is it is separated from the disc. Okay, you have a separation around the disc, separation around the macula. Sometimes you can see two rings as well. But that just indicates it's separated there. Does not mean, yeah, it's floating in a mid-vitreous cavity or anterior-vitreous cavity, freely floating and quite a significant movement. You know more or less, yes, it is there. But does not mean that, yes, that there are no fibers attached to vitreous at all. Posterior migration of vitreous base, that is after PVD, that line what you are seeing, that's a different. But it still can have migration without having PVD. Obviously, migration is always initially at the base posteriorly. That again does not necessarily that you will be a make out PVD. But what have an indirect evidence, this is suppose you have a vitreous patient develop vitreous hemorrhage. Along that line, you will see the vitrea, that blood stops there, doesn't go beyond anteriorly. You will see that line. So that is probably, that is the indication vitreous has separated till that time. You have a detachment. And when you try to separate the vitreous, or when you see fundus examination with a detached retina and you see sharp, some elevated line and then whole retina is dipping. And you have vitreous contracted. So that probably age of vitreous separation there. But still, you can still have vitreous chiasis most of the time. And beyond that age, probably you will not be able to separate that vitreous. It's extremely difficult to say, yes, there is absolutely, I'm sure that there is a complete PVD. Particularly because with things are evolving, better imaging techniques. Previously, what we used to think as vitreous separated, posterior hyaloid separated, you do OCT. And now almost every case of OCT, if you scan into retina, somewhere, some layer, something is stuck there. It's nothing but like a leftover posterior hyaloid most of the time. ERM looks different. Posterior hyaloid looks apparently different. Yeah, but some layer you see, like now almost, I said more than 90% cases, if because of OCT is so sensitive, more than 90% patient they will report as a ERM nowadays.
What does the vitreous floater signify? Sometimes
we
just see a floater, nothing else. Can you tell about the PVD or anything?
No, not really. It can even signify that there's an area of localized condensation of the vitreous. So vitreous floater does not always necessarily mean that there is IPVD. Yes.
Was something history of other pathologies. That's a different vitreous hemorrhage and then left or few spikes of blood, or patient had some inflammation, uveitis you are talking about. those are the different ball game. But you're talking only clear vitreous. Just indicates probably you have pockets of liquefaction. And because vitreous is considered of your collagen, and almost 70, 80%, 90%, 95% or more than 90% of water fluid. So when you start liquefying, naturally it's solid and liquid is separating. So whatever protein or collagen fibers, they are separating and they are now suspended floating in a your fluid. It just signifies that. And obviously it casts shadow on the retina. Now looking at those floaters, now patient how symptomatic he is and also associated pathology, you take a call whether to wait and watch, to observe or associated something else there, depending on that whether to treat or not to.
So yes, I think we should dissect the vitreous base or shave the vitreous base to the extent possible safely without causing more iatrogenic tears. But since the vitreous base, we cannot shave it off entirely. There will definitely be some cortical vitreous which is stuck at the vitreous base. So the role of an encircling band will be that whatever remaining vitreous base is there, or the base that we have not been able to shave off, it will support that vitreous. But I definitely feel that we should do as close a shaving as possible and safely without creating iatrogenic tears, especially inferior breaks.
Where you aim to put? What is location? Anatomical location?
Fossa insertion around 4 mm. Just beyond the equator.
Beyond the equator, why?
Just trying to support the...
And the equator means anterior to equator or posterior to equator or at the equator?
Anterior. We're trying to support the vitreous base.
You want to support, to be very precise, posterior border of vitreous base. Again, because it's irregular. What you say is that migration is there with the age, some changes are there. It is not a line, smooth line, what you have probably. Anteriorly, you have anatomical limitations, but posterior, you have a not like a smooth line. So because it's irregular, again, the contraction of the vitreous sometimes can create a tear, not at that time, during vitrectomy, it can have later on also, particularly if you are doing only scleral buckling, it can have that wave of separation sometime can still cause tear later on. So new breaks, what you see later on, sometime patient come back with new breaks and recurrences, it can be because of that. Now coming back to shaving, yes, you can shave as much as possible and you should. So because leftover vitreous, once your surgical insult is created, you are going to induce some amount of inflammation. So you are going to have vitritis. And when you have inflammatory cascade sets in, you are going to have fibrosis, contracture, and then peripheral vitreous, if contracts further, it will pull, worsen the traction. Okay. So that, again, partly if you shave, so you minimize that, because there's no vitreous to contract most of the time. That's one thing. And basically, again, what we know is probably circumferential contracture, traction is already there, and that's why all these problems you are getting vitreous base-related or peripheral-related. So partly it counteracted with your encircling band, which you reduce circumferential traction. And actually practically reducing a little bit axial length, so you can also help, it helps you to reduce the transvitreal traction, but that probably is true for a buckle when you're doing scleral buckling, because where you are not cutting all vitreous fibers, but when you cut across the circumference, then that situation, roll up belt buckle probably able to take care of left or circumferential traction, not transvitreal, sorry. Okay, and supporting the vitreous base. And shaving the vitreous, again, minimize also further contraction, further circumferential contracture. Given option, shave as much as possible, as far as possible. But if you have a phakic eye or pseudo phakic eye, obviously you cannot go right up to the base. Everything you cannot be shaved. So in fact, those cases obviously definitely is much more necessary to support it. And the basic, what we have already mentioned, basic anatomy is such that vitreous base, whatever you do, like you can induce PVD, but at the base, you cannot take out the entire vitreous. So you cannot say that I have done very good base excision, there is no vitreous left. Nobody can claim. Because anatomically, you cannot remove that one, basically. Okay, and that's why probably here all of us still follow, we still support it. with the encephalitis, particularly when having a hematomatous RD, and I don't think anyone of us really regretted adding the belt buckle. There are two things here. You need to differentiate whether it's persistent HEM or recurrent bleed. So how you define persistent bleed is because you finish your surgery, you left some clot on the table, or you have done a good vitrectomy, but you have still peripheral base, you don't excise here. So leftover peripheral vitreous have some ultra blood trapped in. And at end of surgery, or when patient goes back after a week, there was some clot if things were left, and or some residual HEM was left. So when you come back and you still have diffuse vitreous, and because this peripheral trapped vitreous or clot is going to go get liquefied, get dispersed, and then going to get absorbed. So if you know that history, and when patient comes back, ultrasound shows attached retina, you see that HEM, that probably you define it as a persistent HEM. Or anything, what happened on table, there may not be bleeder. But we also know when you cauterize or when you lift a tiny snip of all this proliferation, over a period of something, between second and third week, when clot contracture, and then those bleeders which were previous bleeders which were they were holding on by clot can ooze again. So that again you will consider as probably persistent bleed. Now that situation, suppose retina is attached, you know I have done good laser. I won't mind because I know what it was done before. So I probably won't mind waiting. But if patient came from outside, I do not know what was done, whether laser or not laser, or I know who has done, I can talk to person and he gives details about intraoperatively what he has done, and then I'll make a decision whether to wait or watch or take for early surgery. But what you define as a recurrent HEM is there was a phase that patient says, typically they come for a glass appointment, they say after operation vision was good. Initially first few days it was not, but slowly it improved. Until last week my vision was good and all of a sudden it become hazy. And that's a typical history, 1 week or 2 week or something like that. That is definitely recurrences. These eyes probably you will ask for even UBM to look for proliferation. The first scenario probably I will not ask for UBM also. I will ask for ultrasound, but ensure the ultrasound that retina is attached, everything is there, and probably send back and wait for maybe a couple of months more. It works out most of the time. But the second scenario, I'll ask for UBM. Yes. And if shows proliferation, definitely the time for intervention. If not, again, if I know intraoperatively I would have done good laser, peripheral area is very well treated, I take a calculated chance to wait and watch. But if you have underlying RD again, you have a layering of the blood, lot of blood is layering, settling down, obviously you know it's not going to clear very soon. So if it doesn't bleed, eventually it will clear, but then it's going to take a very long time. You have associated rubiosis. You show underlying, again, reproliferation or retina getting pulled off. Only one eye, because otherwise the patient is handicapped, then obviously you are not going to wait those scenarios. Probably you go ahead early. Now, because if you are treated proper, like laser is done very well ablated, I won't mind doing just that fluid lavage. Not wheat lavage full place, but just two needle technique or one needle technique, a push pull, we just replace the fluid erection, that sort of thing. Sometime it works, rather most of the time it works. If necessary, you have doubt and you see intraoperatively you could not do peripheral laser or you have not done anything additional because maybe some blood was there, media was easy, I may add along with that ARC along with this one. Okay. So those decisions generally, case to case, you take intraoperatively. But if you have associated anterior hyaloid proliferation, probably I will go in because I need to blast that area. Now, anti-VEGF probably will help you to buy some time. They are not going to take everything away. So if obviously have this anterior hyaloid proliferation, it makes sense, suppose because of systemic condition, patient's health, patient doesn't, cannot, under, not fit for surgery, or patient doesn't want surgery, you give anti-VEGF and you do maybe ARC along with that. And if that helps you to regress peripheral proliferation, just take a calculated chance. Otherwise, and take a next call after maybe month or around 2 months or so, and still bleed persists or recurrent bleed, take first surgery. Now what you need to do is again check with patient whether there is change of medication. Because this patient sometimes any change in a diabetic status, poor general condition, change in a nephrotic state, kidney status, doctor has to change his medication for diabetes, fluctuation, too much of fluctuation, cardiac status, which put on an anticoagulant, rule out those before planning any treatment for that. Because that also can be one of the causes for bleeding. Can be just most of the time, once the general condition stabilizes, get abstop on its own.
Sir, I had a question that we have patients with multiple systemic conditions. They are on anticoagulants a lot of times. Now, let's say that we are doing a surgery for vitreous hemorrhage, probably secondary to PDR. And my question was, so let's say that the physician does say that we can stop anticoagulants. So they're better to stop anticoagulants or let the patient, which are the surgeries in which, specifically from an intraocular bleeding point of view, intrasurgical bleeding, we want the anticoagulants to be stopped.
See, there's a controversy, but there's anticoagulant, basically antiplatelet are different, anticoagulant, again, there are two different categories. Okay, so your, aspirin doesn't make any difference. We need not stop. Okay, but warfarin and group drugs, if a patient is having, probably we prefer to stop. Now, when you anticipate extensive bleeding, membrane is too large, very vascular, florid, and you anticipate intraoperative too much of bleeding, probably again you may think of stopping. But most of the time, we looking at a diabetic eyes, generally there's no need to stop. Most of the time we manage, particularly again your cardiologist says there's a high risk. If you stop anticoagulant, probably we take a calculated chance, go ahead without stopping. Okay? But before surgery, we do bleeding time, clotting time, everything is done. So, but aspirin definitely we do not stop now anymore. And if at all you want to stop this drug, look at their pharmacokinetic. There is no point stopping 3 days before. If you even if you decide no, I am going to stop, I do not want any chance at all, then at least it should be stopped 1 week earlier, and don't give at least 3 days after surgery. Okay. So then makes sense. Not 3 days stopping, 3 days doesn't make sense because already that action, whatever he has taken 3 days back, going to have at least 1 week effect.
Okay.
Glaucoma people, they stop. Orbital surgery, when they are doing, they want to stop because they expect a lot of bleeding there.